take it away, and I'm assuming you don't need the chairs.
I'm going to go from here.
All right. Thank you.
All right, let's do it.
Good morning. I'm Sarah. I'm the CMO at John Anthony Family of Wines, and thanks for including me. I guess I'm speaking a little earlier than I planned. I was going to say I know it's only 10 o'clock here, but it's actually only 9 o'clock here, but it's 1 o'clock somewhere. I'm really excited to tell you how JaM Cellars, the brand, leans into music as a platform for content, connection, and conversation. But for those of you that don't know JaM Cellars, hopefully a few of you have had our wines. We were in the cocktail hour on Sunday, and we'll be in the cocktail hour again tonight. We make butter Chardonnay, jam Cabernet, and toast sparkling. So they say exactly what they are right on the label. We're an easy-to-love California wine brand that you'll find for under $20 pretty much in your favorite local grocery store or liquor store. The brand actually started in the 2008 downturn. And at that point, wine drinking audiences were actually starting to age out, and new demographics weren't really embracing wine in the same way. It was too stuffy, too hard to understand, too hard to buy, inconsistent quality, you never really knew what you were buying. And you could really see that days were numbered for more traditional wine marketing approaches. So that whole idea of points or tasting notes and dinner table pairings. So as a new brand entering the category back then, we knew that we wanted a fresh approach. And I only get 15 minutes with you, so I figured that while a picture is worth 1,000 words, a video hopefully is worth 1,000,000. We should have some volume. We need volume.
Don't want to live as an untold story. Rather go out in a blaze of glory. I can't hear you. I don't fear you. I live now because the bad died last. Your broken past. I can't hear you. I don't fear you now. Wrapped in your regret. What a waste of blood and sweat. Oh, I want to taste love and pain. Want to feel pride and shame. I don't want to take my time. Don't want to waste one life. I want to live.
Yeah, my life is pretty awesome. So I hope it didn't make you too thirsty. You're going to have to save it for later. So here's the JaM Cellars lineup today, if I can get there. Butter Chardonnay is our number one selling SKU. It's also available in butter cans, which are great stocking stuffers. We actually extended the butter brand into Cab and Bubbles earlier this year. I've been with JaM for about 7 years. So I was the very first marketing person. It was just me alone. And at that point, we were in 2015, we were 100,000 cases. And the marketing ecosystem comprised literally a label and a pretty gnarly two-page website. And today, we are 1,000,000 cases. Butter Chardonnay is the number two selling Chardonnay above $12. And it's one of the fastest growing wine SKUs of its generation. So how did we get to this point? So if you ask anyone on the JaM Cellars marketing team, they'll say that we're really not in the wine business. Yes, we were started by Napa Valley Vintners. JaM is actually short for John and Michelle. They were the impossibly good-looking couple in the middle of the video that were being interviewed. We grow grapes, we source grapes, we make great wines in the tradition of great California winemaking. But as I mentioned, this brand was started in 2008, and there was a real desire by the young vintner to make his wines more accessible, easier to understand, and break that mold of vineyard varietal and vintage. And kind of like that whole kind of wine education, telling people how, where, and when to enjoy wines. So my background is not in wine. I spent a couple of decades on the agency side. I have the scars to prove it. And I was looking after big consumer brands, and I really understood the importance of knowing what needs and wants we were truly meeting. And for JaM Cellars, that answer has been super authentic, organic. It's fueled a go-to-market strategy and a marketing ecosystem that I feel really sets us apart. It connects with a younger, emerging, and more diverse wine drinker. And we really compete for share of mind and wallet outside of the wine category. So we feel that JaM Cellars goes beyond the bottle and isn't in the wine business, but is really in the business of creating joy. A lot of the wine industry just takes itself so seriously, and it can be really alienating to customers. So this is a very different value proposition. It's experiential, it's emotional, and it's different for everyone. So it really forces you to make it not about your brand and your product, but about you, our current and future wine lovers. We meet you where you are. We give you permission to enjoy your wines your way and when you want to, which is increasingly beyond the dinner table. And so music came this natural foil for the brand. It shared a lot of parallels, a lot of our core values. It was universal, it was accessible, emotional, experiential, and brings a lot of joy. And a very fun play on our name really kind of gave us permission to lean into that. So the relationship with music actually started pretty small. This is a picture from a much more recent festival that we are presenting sponsor of now. But at the time, back in the day, John and Michelle were actually friends with the organizers of Bottle Rock, and they started to participate. It's a small little unknown festival at the time, right on our doorstep. But that's really when the light went on for us, and we were putting our wines in a joyful setting where lasting memories were being made, and with an audience that was younger than the traditional wine audience, and it felt powerful and connected and bigger than the bottle. But that's just one place. It's just one moment in time, and our wines were really made to be enjoyed any day of the week. I like to say a day of the week with a wine in it. And we knew that while we were popular in California, we knew we needed to reach a national audience and with a lot of frequency. So marketing's mission became bring... Is it going to work? Oh, all right. So our mission became to kind of share that joy across an ecosystem of paid, owned, and earned. And really taking what we were doing in the physical festival space and extending it digitally. So I think it's from your left. We obviously had the Bottle Rock. This is the Jam Pad, which became the official fifth stage of the festival. But then we also added Ohana and other festivals like Kaboo and Voodoo. We sponsored the Coral Sky Amphitheater in Florida. And then in 2016, we opened our own wine and music studio in downtown Napa. And it has like a little recording booth and a stage and a state-of-the-art sound system. We have jam sessions there 3 times a week. We also license our little lineup. We also license our name to a ballroom space in Napa. We've had Chevy Metal and the Struts play there. And we just bought a new space called the Uptown Theater. And we've launched the JaM Cellars Present series. And we had UB40 play there last month, which was very cool. Like, I know everyone who grew up in the 90s now. So we also like extend into paid media. We work a lot with iHeartMedia. They've been a great partner to us, and we work with their on-air influencers. So they're talking about our wines in a music setting. We also do English and Spanish versions of those touch points. And we also extend that into digital with digital streaming audio, OTT, and local mobile. We actually work with Ground Truth, that iHeartMedia white labels the Ground Truth products, and we extend our message to people literally within like half a mile of grocery stores to like help give away tickets, festival tickets that we do as part of our campaigns. And we have our own branded radio station. Got to check it out. It's every artist that's played one of our stages. And it's Summer Festival Jams, poured by JaM Cellars. We're going to be doing a special holiday edition if you like holiday tunes. Born out of COVID times, which I'm really excited about, is we started producing and hosting our own shows online. When festivals kind of like went black, went quiet, we still found a way to connect with people with music. And so we host our own JaM Happy Hours several times a month. And then really dear to my heart and important to our kind of younger demographic is we give back. So we partner with Sweet Relief Musicians Fund for a final Friday JaM Happy Hour every month. And we donate $1 for every like, share, comment during that show, up to $2,500 per show. And it's also become a successful podcast in of its own right as well, which has been really fun to see. And like I said, this is all really super fun. I'm in awe of everything we do, but obviously there's real dollars behind this, and they have to create real value, and we measure everything, and we're pretty scrappy because we have smaller budgets and a small team, and so we have to make sure that the juice is really worth the squeeze, and I'm sorry for the industry pun. I got a little giggle. These are some of the principles we use when we're considering marketing activations. So the first one is really maximizing reach and being religious about that 25 to 30-year-old female that we're connecting with, making sure that, you know, that really truly is a platform to reach her. The next one is strategic orchestration. So everything we do has to be connected and create a halo across our ecosystem. So planning is pretty important. We plan as far out as we can, 12, 18 months, to really socialize programs to trade and retail to get value out of it, so we can plan to get our products on shelf and promotions on shelf, our campaigns, we plan our shoots and our content calendars. It has to be wine first. Both wine and music are fun, and it would be super easy to like go all in on music and kind of forget about the wine, but we have a great quality product, and you know, if we get too far away from that, then this ecosystem means nothing. Another tenet of ours is content elasticity. So we're constantly thinking, like, how do we create modular content? How can we distribute it deeper and further across our ecosystem and plan for the versions we need? How do we increase content longevity? Have we done this before? Can we repurpose something? So for example, at Bottle Rock, we capture content on our JaMPad stage on video. And we actually live stream that on YouTube and Facebook. And then we'll post in social, in reels and stories. We create a long-form rap video that Bottle Rock actually posts on their channels for us, which gets great reach. And then we repurpose that content throughout the year on social for Throwback Thursdays or Music Mondays. And then we'll also use that content to promote our flyaway and giveaway that we're promoting on iHeartRadio. And we'll also play the content at our wine and music studio. So it just has a lot of versatility. Multi-threshold engagement is really important to us as well, so making sure that we've got engagements throughout the funnel, not everything. I mean, we have a strong call to action to locate. You know, that's how you buy our wines. You can buy through the fourth tier now, Instacart Drizzly, Amazon Fresh, but mostly it's driving people to brick and mortar. But the other, like, more snackable touch points are really important too. And, you know, it's a win for us even if we inspire somebody to open a bottle of wine that they've already purchased. Multi-dimensional frequency, so really staying top of mind. We rarely invest in anything that is a one and done or a single touch point. We just don't have time for that. We're not selling one bottle of wine per person a year, and so it really does take a lot. And we're part of like a set. You know, people will drink more than one wine brand, and so they're making those choices on at a pretty high frequency level. So being top of mind and driving that familiarity and the connection between the yellow label that they might see online and then see it in the store. And lastly is stakeholder currency. So we have a lot of different stakeholders. We have trade and retailers, as well as our consumers, and then our brand loyals and our direct-to-consumer audience as well. So how are we creating value? Can we create hospitality at an event that we're sponsoring? Can we use it for incentives for merchandisers? And then for consumers, is it really creating joy? Is it creating entertainment? And then for our brand loyals, are there ways for them to share the content and really kind of advocate for the brand? And we put those stakeholders at the table whenever we're evaluating something. And if you knew me, you'd know that I'm going to end on some numbers. My team was actually pretty surprised that I didn't have an Excel spreadsheet here for you. So my fancy slides that build. So far, we've delivered 3.8 billion impressions just from music festivals. And our engagement rates on those activations are well into the double digits. We've delivered 8 million radio minutes listened on our radio station. 600 live jam sessions have been recorded, and shout out to Dave Grohl, loved having him on the jam pad, nice guy. 5,000 jam happy hour downloads and 20,000 minutes listened. We've got a growing community of followers and subscribers on these touch points. We're on track to raise 75,000 by the end of this year for Sweet Relief. And we're averaging right now in 2022 10 million impressions per day. But what's more important is that while this year the wine industry experienced a pretty big slowdown as kind of that millennial emerging audience was favoring ready-to-drinks or spirits. And so while they were all slowing down, Jam Cellars in Southern Wines and Spirits' portfolio, we are one of two wine brands that actually grew this year. So I'm going to take full credit for that. And so we're selling a bottle of butter approximately every 35 seconds. Oh, there goes another one. So thank you so much for letting me share our brand, and I look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Sarah.
Oops, a little loud.
Anyone have any questions for Sarah?
Hi, Sarah.
Hi.
Lovely presentation. Love the play of words.
Thank you.
Brilliant. Your team must have really creative marketing folks. My question is more so around the connection between Cannes and Music Festival. Are they linked? And if they are, which came first? Did the Music Festival idea come first, or did you have Cannes then too?
I was actually... Oh. It was loud. I was actually consulting with Bottle Rock Napa Valley when John and Michelle came in as the second stage sponsor, and that's where I first met them. So music definitely came first. At that point, butter was growing. It was on a tear, like almost triple digit growth in the first few years. And we were a very small team. I was employee number 7. And so what we decided to do was really focus on the 750. And get that through some big pipes. We didn't have Southern at the time. It had grown very hodgepodge with some really small distributors, and we knew that we needed a like, much bigger system. And so those first few years were really focused on the 750s, building out the infrastructure, and then we started to extend the line, create new products. We were actually being asked for Cannes. Whole Foods actually asked us for Cannes back in 2017, and we didn't actually launch them, I think, until about 2019, so we waited.
All right, and then so the Cannes launch or getting into that product segment is not to compete with the beers and recruiting the shoppers over from beer, because the younger demographic predominantly indulges in, and I don't know if you're trying to, because you're not, you say you're not in the business of wine, so is that the strategy then?
Yeah, no, the product itself, so butter Chardonnay, like the way that it's play on words and it's really informal, that was all about kind of attracting a younger demographic. And obviously, yes, we knew that Cannes were going to do that even more. But it also gives us like extra drinking occasions. It's not really a demographic strategy. It's more of a drinking occasion strategy.
I actually wanted to ask you about...
Dave Grohl.
Yes, of course. But when you talk about how you're sharing it on social, and you kind of went into that, but you said some of it's earned, some paid. What's the percentage of that? Like, how much do you have to invest to really make what you're doing at these particular events really then cross over to everyone nationally.
Yeah, it's all paid now. I mean, you just can't get any reach with, like, Facebook has really done a number on every advertiser, and I see CPMs going up year after year. It's becoming more and more difficult. We get a little bit of organic reach, maybe like 6 to 8%. We get some user-generated content, and we get some really good earned impressions. But in order to, like, really get those big numbers in impressions, you have to pay.
So you need to invest to follow up with it to make it all really yeah. make sense instead of just, okay, one and done.
Yeah, exactly.
Great. And I do know we have a question here.
Oh, hello.
I was not going to ask this question, but I guess I'm on the spot now.
No, I'm on the spot.
My name is Sam. I am the newest employee of Media Post.
And nobody died on his kayak trip.
Nobody died on my kayak trip. Throughout college and a little bit right now, I've worked in the music industry. And one thing, I work for Live Nation, actually. And So one thing that I've heard over and over and over again is that Live Nation kind of has just like a monopoly right now. Like Live Nation with AEG has like a monopoly on the music industry. And so I was just kind of curious about like if there was any barriers to entry when you're trying to get into this industry and like navigating with Live Nation or AEG, or if you guys are just completely separate from them.
No, Bottle Rock is actually got bought by Live Nation after we've been working with them for a couple of years. And then all of a sudden you find out that all of the other festivals are owned by Live Nation as well. And then they know how much you're paying for one festival and they're like jacking the price up on the other festivals. And so, yeah, it really is a monopoly. But they're the only game in town. And so we like to partner with them and be a good partner, and just something that you have to accept if you want to be in the world of music.
Hello, Lee Shea, Johnson & Johnson. Two questions. One is serious, one's a little cheeky. The first one is, what is the approach for the category with respect to data privacy, right? Because there's age limitations, right, within the product. So how do you guys think about that when you're targeting in the music space, right?
Yeah.
The second one is, what is the company's approach to a glass of wine during lunch?
Maybe I'll answer the second question first. We actually have a bar inside our office space. Yeah.
Are you looking for anyone?
But you'd be surprised how infrequently I have to literally like tell my team to like go to the wine fridge on a Friday afternoon because they're all super dedicated and passionate. And so you kind of find when you're, I think it's like the European angle, right? So you like are having wine with dinner when you're like 6 years old or something, and then, you know, you're not really worried about it. And so actually when it's freely available, people don't abuse it. The first question, it's really serious, and we're very regulated. And so things like TikTok are a big no for us. Facebook and Instagram are great, but really they're very tight on age gating. And we're very serious about that. You know, you have to be because we've become a really big brand now, and you know, we've got a target on our back. Everybody else is looking to say, well, how are they doing it? And so we do have good lawyers, and we do like push the boundaries a little bit. We've got a really fun campaign coming up in December that I might talk a little bit more about tomorrow during the panel. But it's serious business. Thank you.
Anyone else? All right. Well, Sarah, thank you so much. And we had to pull you in early, so we appreciate